my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Kin Wah Fung. Dr. Fung was a consultant surgeon before moving into the field of medical informatics. He led the planning and implementation of clinical information systems in 14 Hong Kong public hospitals, serving over 5 million patients. Dr. Fung developed the core problem list subset of SNOMED CT in RX terms and serves on advisory groups at the office of at the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology and the International Health Terminology Standards Development Organization. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kin Wah Fung. Dr. Fung.
Thank you, Dr. Kapali, for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me to this conference. I'm here to talk about health data standards and open science activities at the National Library of Medicine. So I would like to start by thanking my colleagues, Liz Amos, Steve Emmerich, Valerie Florence, and Mike Herter, for allowing me to use their slides in this presentation. So the National Library of Medicine is the designated central coordinating body for clinical terminologies within the DHHS, or the Department of Health and Human Services. And we do this by working very closely with the Office of National Coordinator for Health IT, and to make sure that our efforts are well aligned with the goal of creating a national infrastructure where there's an interoperable health system to improve the quality and efficiency of healthcare. And we promote the adoption and use of health data standards by the following activities. So first of all, we either develop ourselves or directly fund or provide access to important clinical terminologies that are to be used in the electronic health record. So these are what we call the big three. I mean, in our NLM speak, there are SNOMED CT, LOINC, and RX norm. And in the later part of my presentation, I'll talk more in detail about these terminologies. So we also develop tools and other resources to help or facilitate the use and reuse of these terminologies. We also carry out ourselves, or we fund or support research in related areas such as clinical vocabulary standards, semantic interoperability, and also natural language processing. And last but not least, we also provide education and training for medical informatics professionals in this area of health data standards. So, start with, I would like to talk a little bit about medical terminologies and what are they? What is a medical terminology? So to put it simply, I would say a medical terminology is just a finite set of terms. By terms, I usually mean either some a single word or sometimes a phrase or rarely even a sentence that is used to convey medical information unambiguously in a specified domain. So what do terminologies do? So in my mind, they do two things. First of all, they enable computers to understand the information that is being stored in the in a computer. These are usually entered by human beings. And we need some aid to help the computer because free text or free narrative text is too complicated still for computers to understand. And secondly, by using the terminology, we give a very convenient handle for the computer to process information. So we give a handle, which is usually in form of a code, to a piece of meaning, so that facilitates the processing of information by a computer. So here an analogy would be like, I suppose most of us here would have been exposed to learning computer programming languages. So the first thing that we do when we learn a computer programming language is to learn a set of controlled words or reserved words, like go to, do while, or for next, right? So these are the words that are actually symbols that will help us communicate with the computer, and so that we can instruct the computer to do whatever is necessary to do. So in medical terminology, the same is true. So we need a set of medical terminologies so that the computer can understand what we're trying to say to it. And the medical terminology helps the computers to understand the meaning of very complicated medical, the field of complication, of the field of medical science, which is very complicated, by restricting the content, that is the scope of what we're saying, and also the syntax of what is being said, or how it's being said. So why is free narrative text very difficult to understand? So here are some examples. So the first thing is there can be multiple ways to express the same meaning in our normal everyday speak. For example, if we say the medicine is to be taken through the mouth, we can say that orally or peroral, or even a PO or by mouth. There are many ways to say the same thing. On the flip side, there's also ambiguity. That means the same words can mean different things. For example, when we say there's a gunshot in the atrium, so is the atrium the place that the gunshot is happening, or is it a body part, right? So COLD, cold, as a word, it can mean at least two things, right? Cold as the temperature cold, or the common cold. And it can be also an acronym for chronic obstructive lung disease. So all this is very difficult for the computer to understand or distinguish. Of course, in the medical record, we'll find a lot of examples whereby a certain term is actually modified in its meaning by how it's appeared. For example, a family history of breast cancer will not be interpreted as something that is related to the patient herself. And in a medical record, we sometimes list things that we think are possible diagnosis as differential diagnosis, or we also other times release things that have already been excluded. For example, possible pneumonia, or that myocardial infarction has been excluded. And last but not least, I mean, we also have spelling variants like British versus American spellings, and sometimes even typos. So there's a special branch of medical informatics called natural language processing, which attempts to help computers understand natural language on free narrative text. There's a lot of progress in this field, I mean, in recent decades, but still is far from being perfect. And by and large, digital medical information is still much more useful if it is encoded in a standard terminology. So here's a summary of the benefits of encoding information by terminology. So for retrieval, because the information will be indexed by codes, so retrieval will be very fast, complete, and accurate. And most terminologies will offer some kind of organization of the terms or the concepts in it. So there will be groupings and hierarchies. So this will facilitate analysis of medical data by aggregation and also summarization of individual instance of codes. Of course, reasoning, it will be facilitated because there's symbolic handle to the meaning that the computer is handling. So like for clinical decision support, it will be easier to work with encoded information than just free text. And of course, if you want to share information between systems, it will be very useful to have a standard way of encoding that information so that the information passed on will be understood as it's intended to be. So next I'll just give a couple of examples how encoding information in standard in a medical terminology will help to enhance the function of an electronic health record. So in this case, we're talking about data retrieval. Let's imagine for a while that, okay, in your hospital system, the lab results of this, all the patients, I mean, over the length of time, they're all stored as pages of information, pages of lab reports, like usually they are like images of PDF format. So if you want to ask the computer, okay, can you show me the fasting blood sugar of Mr. X in the past 6 months? The computer would draw a blank because there's no way that computer can understand what is being stored. But if you contrast this with the case of a structured medical record that that has different fields for different values, and that all the lab tests are encoded in a standard coding system, like in this case, LOINC, which is being used for a lot of lab tests. So it will be very easy to recognize the entries that are related to the test that you're looking for. In this case, you're looking for fasting blood glucose, and the LOINC code for that is 1558-6. And if you ask the same question, it will be very easy for a computer to pull out the values that you're interested in. You can put it in, the computer can then put it in a tabular form, or you can do graphing, and there's just a lot of more possibilities of presenting and retrieving the same information. The second example I would like to give is clinical decision support. Say, if in your hospital, the physicians want to implement this rule, say, every time the physician is about to prescribe a nephrotoxic drug, to a patient who already has impaired renal function, we want to have the system to kind of remind the physician to adjust the dosage of the drug. So in order to do that, the computer needs to know at least two things. First of all, is the patient's renal function normal? So in order to determine whether the patient's renal functions are normal, the computer may look for cues that the patient's renal function is impaired. So we'll look for words like acute renal failure or chronic renal failure or impaired renal function. Another thing the computer can do is to look at lab tests, okay, to look at renal function tests to see whether the results are normal or not. So another thing the computer needs to know is whether the doctor is prescribing something that is potentially harmful to the kidneys. So it may have a list of drugs, gentamicin, tobramicin, that it will be looking for. Now imagine in the first scenario that you only have like free text data in your medical record. So, and then this is the food, that this is the part that is describing the patient's history and allergy condition, problems and so on. And if you only use your list of words that you're looking for in order to answer the question of whether you should fire the alarm or not, you're likely to run into false negatives and false positives. Say in this example, the patient is suffering from type 2 diabetes with nephropathy. So, and lo and behold, you left out nephropathy as one of the words that you're looking for, because you're looking for only renal failure, renal impairment. So this will be a false negative. And further on, if you look for, if your medical record is unstructured, then you'll be looking all over the place for example, chronic renal failure. But it still happens that this patient has a family history of a mother dying from chronic renal failure. So that will be a false positive. And gentamicin is another example here, and is mentioned as one of the drugs that the patient is allergic to. So this will be picked up as well. So contrast this with the scenario where you have a structured information where all the information is encoded in standard terminologies. So the computer will know that it should look at the proper sections in EHR, like the problem list, to find diagnoses that are applicable to the patient. So in this case, if the diagnosis or the problem list is encoded in SNOMED, it's even better, because in a structured terminology, usually it's much easier to pull out the relevant records without relying on just words themselves. So it's easy to find all the patients have diagnoses that are indicating that their renal functions are impaired. So the computer will skip family history because it's not relevant in this case, and the allergy list. And you will also be able to look at the lab results. In this case, there's a serum creatinine, which is abnormal, and the computer will be able to pick it up. And also the computer will look at the prescription field to see whether actually the patient is being prescribed the relevant drug. So in the next few slides, I'm going to go through some of the big three I mentioned earlier, terminologies that we are supporting or providing. So I'm glad that I'm not the first one to mention snow at CT, because it's mentioned by Dr. Balaji and Dr. Fusuma this morning. So, but I'm going to give you a little bit more background and detail about snow at CT. So snow at CT in full is the systematized nomenclature of medicine clinical terms. It is indeed the most comprehensive clinical healthcare terminology in the world. And it has rapidly becoming the international clinical terminology standard. And currently, the SNOMED is owned by an international organization. Before, SNOMED was developed by the College of American Pathologists. And in order to make it a more international terminology, in 2007, the ownership has been transmitted to an international body called the International Health Terminology Standards Development Organization. Because it's quite a mouthful to say these six words, so since the beginning of this year, IHTSU has acquired a new name called SNOMED International, which is much easier to say. And since 2007, the membership of IHTSU or SNOMED International has increased more than three times. So now it's more than 30 countries. And to use SNOMED CT, you do need a license, but the good news is the license is free for everybody that is in the member countries. It is also free for 40 low-income countries as defined by the World Bank. And for certain research or humanitarian or charitable projects, they can also apply for a free license to use SNOMED as well. So according to the meaningful use incentive of CMS to encourage the use of EHR, the certification criteria requires that SNOMED CT to be used in the following fields, including the problem list, procedure, smoking status, some lab results, and family history, and also as reporting to a cancer registry. So what are the benefits of using SNOMED CT? Because the first benefit is that it's very comprehensive in its coverage. It's over 300,000 concepts, covering not just diseases and symptoms, but also procedures, body parts, microorganisms, and drugs, and so on. So in comparison to ICD-9-CM or ICD-10-CM, it is much better coverage. 9-CM only has about 14,000 codes, and 10-CM is bigger, but it's only about 68,000. And what is good about SNOMED CT is that it is extensible, not like ICD-9-CM or 10-CM. So if you don't find something that you need in SNOMED CT, there's a way to create your own meaning by modifying concepts in a standardized and disciplined way to create new meaning. This is what we call post-coordination. And the second advantage of SNOMED CT is that the names or the terms are very clinically friendly, because these are actually taken out of normal everyday clinical discourse. Unlike some of the terms of ICD, which will be hard to understand by a physician. And because SNOMED CT is defined by an underlying logical definition using description logic, so it is much more computable compared to ICD-9 or 10-CM. So because of this computability, it allows for very flexible data entry or data retrieval strategies. So next I'm going to talk about a close relative of SNOMED, which is SNOWDENT. As mentioned by Dr. Balaji, it's developed and maintained by the American Dental Association. It is a subset of SNOMED CT, and it's about 8,000 concepts in total. Like SNOMED itself, it's across multiple hierarchies, findings, procedures and body size and so on. And it is exactly the same structure as SNOMED CT. The three main components are concepts, which are the main thing in SNOMED CT or SNOWDENT, and they are identified by unique identifiers, SNOMED identifiers and SNOWDENT identifiers, the description and the names, and also the relationships. They are either the defining relationships or the hierarchical relationships. So what is more about Snow then is that it has maps to ICD-9CM, ICD-10CM, and CDT. So that makes it very useful if you want to generate any of those administrative terminologies for other purposes. So SNOMED follows a semi-annual update schedule similar to SNOMED CT, and license is granted by ADA, but there's no charge for use of SNOMED. And there's a very close collaboration relationship between ADA and SNOMED International. And under that collaborative agreement, they're undertaking the following activities. First of all, SNOMED and SNOMED will be harmonized to make sure that when each is updated, they will not be out of sync. And also ADA will provide subject matter experts through the International Dentistry Special Interest Group to improve the dental contents in SNOMED CT. And like Dr. Walsh mentioned this morning, there's already a development, a general dentistry subset being developed, and it will be available with the January 2017 update of SNOMED CT, which will be available by the end of this month. There's another subset for odontogram, which is under development. So what are the benefits of using SNOMED? From the patients and healthcare providers' perspective, I mean, SNOMED will facilitate the capture of more consistent, accurate, and complete information. So we're moving beyond just procedures, right? It's everything including treatment, procedures, and other things. And there will also be the opportunity of providing point of care clinical decision support, and also care coordination can be automated, like generation of follow-up reminders. And of course, sharing of information will be much easier if things are encoded with the same underlying terminology. From a public health perspective, if better information is being captured at the patient level in the electronic health record, there's the possibility of electronic reporting of this information for public health purposes, and this will lead to higher quality demographic and clinical data, and which will in the end lead to the identification and monitoring of oral health issues. From a research perspective, SNOMED is also very useful because it provides a standardized way to describe dental conditions and also to identify patients with certain clinical characteristics. And it will facilitate analysis of patient care services, quality of care, outcome, and cost effectiveness. So next I'm moving on to another terminology called LOINC. So LOINC is the logical observation identifiers, names, and codes. And it is the international standard for laboratory tests, measurements, and observations. It's developed by the Regenschrief Institute. First release is over 20 years ago. And NM is one of the funder of this activity. It's available at no cost. And it is in meaningful use is a designated terminology for laboratory tests and some other data elements. And LOINC is actually used very heavily in the communication or transfer of clinical data between between computer systems, particularly in the lab arena, especially in HR7 or health level 7 messages. So here's an example of an HR7 message that will and the relations and how LOINC can be used. So the problem is if you don't have a terminology like LOINC, so all the different sites, this might be individual labs, they will transmit their results in, this is a typical HR7 version 2 message. So the syntax is kind of complicated, but then just take my word for it that the ones highlighted in the OBX is the name of the segment, which means observations. So the third field and the fifth field, the third field is the name of the test that you're performing, and a fifth field is the result. So before you have a standard terminology, then the labs will say, okay, I perform this test, which is called ABO, or BLD TYP, or ABO type, and then the result is O type O, or O pos, all right? So for a human being, I mean, reading this, he or she may be able to guess that, I mean, this is similar results, they're the same results, right? But then for computers, it's very difficult to for computers to know that they are the same results. But when there's LOINC, then all the lab tests for this ABO bad group will be encoded in the same way, and the results will be encoded in the same way if you use some CT as the code for the results. So what we're saying is, LOINC can be used as the universal coding system for clinical observations, and we use usually LOINC as the question or the lab test, and we encode SNOW-SCT as the result of the test. So making that the interpretation of the results will be unambiguous. So LOINC is a truly international terminology. It is used in over 170 countries by a lot of people, and it's been translated to many, many languages. So the last of the three terminologies I want to talk about is called RxNorm. This is related to drugs and is created and maintained by ourselves. RxNorm serves two goals. First of all is to provide a standardized way of naming drugs, and the second one is to support semantic interpretation, interoperation. The scope of RxNorm is just to cover clinical drugs, and by clinical drugs, we mean pharmaceutical products that are given to a patient for therapeutic or diagnostic intent. And things that are like contrast food, contrast media, or dietary supplements, they're outside the scope of RxNorm. And here's some examples of how RxNorm is being used in the US. So CMS is using it to populate its formula reference file to determine Part D eligibility. And it's also used in the creation of clinical data measurement value sets. So by meaningful use, RxNorm is required for medications and also allergies. The NCPDP, National Council for Prescription Drug Programs, has designated RxNorm as the standard in its e-prescribing standard, and also the formulary and benefit standard. The VA and DoD, they are using RxNorm for integration of drug information between their systems. So next I just want to have talk a little bit about mapping. So whenever the same kind of information is being encoded in more than one kind of terminologies, there's the need for mapping will arise. So generally, why do we need to map between terminologies? So usually a map will serve one of two purposes. The first one is, if you already have some information that is encoded in one terminology and you want to translate the same information to another terminology, so you need a map. One common example is if in your EHR you have clinical information encoded in SNOW-CT and you want to generate ICD-10 CM codes for reimbursement. So you need a map between SNOW-CT and ICD-10 CM so that you don't have to code two times. Another use of a map would be data integration. So in this age of big data, it's common that you find heterogeneous source of data. For example, one pool of data is coming from claims data, and another one is coming from a clinical system. Usually, they use different coding systems for the same domain. So if you have a map, then it's possible to integrate these pools of information together to do your analytics. So here are some of examples of existing maps, for example, between ICD-9, CM, and SNOWMAP. And NLM, we create and maintain two maps, and basically they are from SNOWMAP-CT to ICD-10, both ICD-10, CM, and 9, CM. So Next, I'm going to talk a little bit about education and training provided by NLM. So we have a yearly week-long immersive course in Georgia, which is run in partnership with Augusta University on biomedical informatics. At our campus, we also take in, we also have a medical informatics training program. We take in trainees from all stages of their career. We have summer programs, we have clinical electives, and we also have like postdoc fellowship positions and visiting scientist positions. And in addition to that, we also give grants for extramural research programs. And notably, NLM is the only institute among the 24 NIH institutes and centers that are awarding grants. NLM is the only institute that whose grants focus solely on biomedical informatics or information science research. So next, I'm going to shift gear to talk about our open science activities. So this is the traditional paradigm. So as a researcher would do experiments or observations to gather data. And from the data, he or she would generate generalizable knowledge and publish it and as scientific knowledge. So open science is the paradigm in which, I mean, we're not only relying on the data that we ourselves collect, we are relying on sharing this data to generate generalizable knowledge. And the more we practice open science, actually the easier it becomes, and also there's more incentive to share data. So this is kind of like a feedback loop. And also we should expand our scope when we say we're sharing data, because we're not only sharing data, we have to think about the different things that we can share in open science. So there's a term called digital research objects, which we can share, which includes not only data, but also software, publications, workflows, or even algorithms. So until recently, most domains of biomedicine, so with the notable exception of genomics, genomics are very advanced in the field, I mean, for sharing data and findings, right? So except genomics, the most of biomedicine, they're not really data-centric, or they're not open, they're not used to sharing data. So for these domains that are what we call non-data-centric, the major products of research would be scientific papers, and that describes the author's ideas about the data or about the experiment. So it's like just looking at the tip of the iceberg. What is underneath, which is the real data that is supporting the hypothesis or theory, the data is never seen, and much less being shared. But the good news is, this is about to change. So force to change can come from like four different directions. First of all, we're living in an age whereby sharing is the norm, right? We have all the social media and we're so used to sharing. And more, there are more policy directives from different funders of research that actually requires researchers to share information. And of course, with technical advance, it's much easier and more feasible to share large volumes of data nowadays. And of course, there are new opportunities in science that will encourage the sharing of data. So, I mean, our hope and wish is that, I mean, all domains will one day become open and all data will be shared. So what are the advantage of sharing data? So if you just consider a single study, if you share your data, they will allow the reader to have a deeper understanding of the scientific meaning of the paper. And also, I mean, other researchers can do reanalysis of the data and can get new insights. If you think across studies, then say that rigorous sharing or comparison of across studies is possible if you share the data so that we increase the validity of your research. If you aggregate the data that across studies, you can have higher statistical power. And also, you may be able to share, aggregate data that in ways that are not possible before. Like you can aggregate heterogeneous sources of the data and get new insights. And of course, collaboration will be promoted. In terms of efficiency, if you share your data, it is not only your positive results, right? You're necessarily also sharing things that are not called negative results. So the negative results will also be shared and inspected by other researchers. So this will prevent unnecessary duplication of our effort. So similar things will not be repeated unnecessarily. And this is also, sharing of data will also increase the accountability because, obviously if you share your data, you're showing people what you have actually done and what you have achieved, okay? So they will maximize the return of investment on this particular research. And also this will enhance reproducibility and replicability of research. So how do we share data? I think it's now generally agreed that the FAIR principle is the right way to share data. And what is the FAIR principle? First of all, the data has to be findable, okay? How do you make data findable? So the data has to be accompanied and described by the metadata, and all these elements, metadata and data themselves, they have to be assigned unique identifiers, and they have to be put in a searchable medium or resource so that other people can find it. It has to be accessible, so both the metadata and the data has to be retrievable through a standardized protocol. The data has to be interoperable. So this is where the discussion about standard terminologies and mapping between terminologies will come in. So if the data is all encoded in standard terminologies, or that the terminologies used, even though they are not the same, there's a way to integrate them. So we have truly interoperable data. And the last criteria is that the data has to be reusable. So if you share data, you have to also share that the conditions or usage license or requirements that is necessary for people to use the data, and also a clear description of the provenance of the data. So next I'm going to describe various activities at the National Library of Medicine that will support open science and make data increase the fairness of data. The first example I have here is PubMed Central. So the aim of PubMed Central is to provide free access to full text biomedical data in life science journal articles. It is started in 2000, and right now it is over 3 million full text articles stored in it. And it's easy, it is linked to PubMed, so it's, if you find an article on PubMed, you can click a link. If there's a PubMed Central article that is full text, you can link directly from there. And since 2008, so NIH has this new rule that all the researchers that are publishing on NIH-funded research, they need to submit the article to PubMed Central within 12 months of the publication. So the next example I have is clinicaltrials.gov. So clinicaltrials.gov is a registry and a resource database of all the publicly and privately supported clinical trials, not only from America, but also from around the world. The first public release of the site is in 2000, and now we not only have registry of the clinical trials themselves, we also have the results from the trials, but this is only at the aggregate level, but not at the individual patient level. And the first release of the results database is in 2008. So currently, clinicaltrials.gov listed list about over 200,000 studies, and over 40,000 of them are still active. They're still recruiting patients. It covers every state in the US and over 195 countries. The main users of clinicaltrials.gov include patients, their families, caregivers when they look for clinical trials, healthcare professionals, clinical researchers, and other people. And clinicaltrials.gov now has over 200 million page views per month. Next, I'm going to talk about the Value Set Authority Center, or VSAC. So what are value sets? So value sets are simply put, they're code sets being drawn from standard terminologies to describe or define some clinical characteristics. Let's say, for example, define whether the patient is a smoker or a diabetic. And usually the purpose is to support certain specified use cases, like for cohort definition in research or for clinical quality measure. So VSAC provides a one-stop shop for all the published value sets. And VSAC is also searchable, and you can download all the value sets very conveniently. And it's accessible through an application programming interface, or API. And VSAC also provides an offering or collaborative platform for value set authors. This is important because, this is just an example of a value set. For example, this is how you may define the smoking status of a patient. And this is a list of all the SNOMED codes that you can use to describe the patient's smoking status. So until very recently, the development of value set is just happening in silos. So there's a lot of repetition. So individual value sets that are sort of very common purposes that are developed by value set authors. So we hope that with the authoring platform that is provided by VSAC, we'll be able to improve this. So first of all, having a common platform will provide useful utility to the value set creators, because of course terminologies change and they get updated. So with the central support of the terminology server, the value set authors will be able to see which codes are being obsolete, and they will be able to find replacements in the new version of the terminology. And more importantly, with a centralized collaborative environment, the value set authors will be able to look at what other people have created, and so that they will not have need to duplicate if there's already a value set that fits their use case. So the last example that I'm going to give about NIM's activity on open science is the NIH Common Data Element Repository. So a Common Data Element, or CDE, is usually a representation of a variable, usually a question, like in a questionnaire or research protocol. It can be common to multiple studies. For example of such a question would be, how often do you consume alcohol? So usually the response is a fixed list of values. For example, not at all, some days, every day. So in the CDE repository, every CDE is defined unambiguously in a human and a machine readable format. And people can pick their CDEs and to create and combine them together into a complete questionnaire or survey instrument. So this is just a screenshot of our website, cde.nih.nim.nih.gov, and it will allow you to browse all the CDEs available. So what are the benefits of reusing CDEs? So what is the purpose of having a repository of all CDEs? So the obvious benefit is if every study is carried out with the same basic core set of CDEs, so your data collection will be more uniform and the data will be more comparable. And it will be easier to aggregate different studies and to pool the results together. And CDEs can also be useful in promoting research. In improving the efficiency, for example, you can just pick existing CDEs, you don't have to invent your own. And what is More is that these CDEs are often already validated previously, so there's scientific validity in these data elements already. And these are, since these are defined, machine-readable and human-readable form, so there's no ambiguity of what the data element means. And of course, using a common set of CDEs will enhance the sharing of results from different studies. And it will also allow for more rigorous comparison between studies. So in this last slide, I would like to just summarize NLM's role and vision in open science and data science. So in the year 2015, under the NH Director's Advisory Committee to the Director, there's a special NLM working group. The task is to identify the future roles for NLM. And in that report, among other things, it is said that NLM should be the intellectual and programmatic epicenter for data science at NIH, and to support and stimulate its advancement through biomedical research and application. And it's also said that NLM should lead efforts to support and catalyze open science, data sharing, and research reproducibility. And very recently, just about 2 weeks ago, our new NIM director, Dr. Patty Brennan, has been appointed as the NIH Interim Associate Director for Data Science. And right now, NIM is undergoing a series of strategic planning activities, which will last until the end of this year. And there are four themes of our strategic planning. And one of the main themes is to advance data science, open science, and informatics. So the message I would like to bring is that NLM is in this for the long haul, and we are fully committed to advance, promote, and encourage open science and data science. So with that, I'll end my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fung. So we only have time for one short question. So if anybody has a follow-up question, just in the interest of time. One question?
Okay. I got off the
Thank hook. You again, Dr. Fung.